child died, I was going to have. Everything else came up pretty good. I questioned his order, because I felt like he'd abandoned me, for the most part. And here's the times that he broke through, but for the most part, I didn't feel like he was there. But yet his word told me he's always there. So I had so many questions, so many doubts, and I was ashamed of that. I never doubted and questioned God like I had at this point. But by June 18th, I was off the antidepressant. I had not been taking that dose of my thyroid medication anymore, and my brain started clearing. And by June 18th, I could think well enough to realize I had to make a decision. I had to choose. Was I going to believe my thoughts, my feelings, or the Word of God? John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14 says, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. So I am going to believe the Word of God. I'm believing him. Right? If I'm trusting what I read in the Bible, I'm trusting him. Because he is the Word. And that was the choice I made on June 18th. I thought, no matter what, I'm going to believe it. Whatever it says from the beginning of Genesis to the end of Revelation, I'm going to believe it. No matter how I feel, no matter what I think, no matter what appears to me, that's what I'm going to believe and trust. Isaiah 42:16 says, I will lead the blind by ways they have not known, along unfamiliar paths. Turn the darkness into light before you and make the brightness a smooth. These are the things I will do. I will not forsake. And that is a perfect picture of my depression. I was blind. And he did lead me. And it was work. And he did turn the darkness into light. And he did not forsake me. And yet I believed he did. So that verse was very, very important to me. His word is full of promises. I know you all know this. Promises of love, care, provision, protection, healing, deliverance, and freedom. And Jesus didn't come just to save us. He came to heal and deliver and set us free. He tells us that in Luke chapter 4. So, you spend all this time on that middle part of the verse, as you trust in him. And taking a look at how hard it can be to fully trust God. I mean, it was the biggest faith crisis of my life that I've experienced. I hope I never experience one that big again. So let's move on to what's the payoff. When you fully trust him, the payoff is he will fill you with all joy and peace. When we surrender and choose to trust God, he gives us joy, which is an emotion of great. And in my video, twirling, did you see joy? I think my face looks very joyful. Because it does give us joy. It gives us peace. What is peace? It's the absence of mental stress and anxiety. And if you know someone who is truly peaceful, I think they're unique. At least in our society. I don't think we're really a very peaceful people. But he wants us to be. And trusting him is a key. Now, do I always get this perfect? No. Do I still sometimes go down the path of worry? Yes. I don't go down it as far as I used to. Because I've got so many good remembrances of what he's done for me. I've got beacons of light that I tell myself. I can look at his word for what he's done for others. You, your stories I've heard. All these things that remind me. He's on his throne. He's in control. And so that's what grounds me back on the right path. So why does he give us the joy and the peace? Is it all for me? Is it all for you? No. So that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. What he pours into me, what he pours into you, he wants to pour out of us again for others. It's very circular. And you know, he called me to write my book, and I was very shocked, not happy, because I had worked real hard, you know, around for all those months to hide this from my family. There were only three people that knew everything. My pastor's wife, my husband, and my best friend. My mother knew a lot, but she didn't know everything. My daughter saw a lot, but she didn't know everything. My son didn't know, because he lived out of town, and I could keep it hidden. My extended family didn't know. My church knew something was wrong, because I was not this candy. I was totally morphed into a different person. And yet I didn't tell them. So one thought I was on some kind of mystical journey, which was very odd to me. Like on a map or something. Another thought I had cancer, which I was really glad of. I'm like, isn't that terrible, girl? Like, I believe I had cancer instead of depression. But I kept it hidden. Yet that's not what God wants us to do. Because this way, through my story, others can know there's hope. And others can see the truth. And hopefully be blessed by it. And then I believe it's why he called me into ministry. Because, you know, I wrote the book and it's like, hey, did it, Lord, done? He's like, no, 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 I want you to go out and tell people. No. You know, this is not anything I ever thought I'd be doing. Either one, the book or this ministry. But yet, it's where I always feel the most alone. You know, I love telling my story and what God's done. And my Living Hope ministry is online. I've got a webpage, I've got a Facebook page, I have a YouTube channel, and every week I publish blogs. These are video blogs, that's why I'm recording today. And about 10 minutes long, and they incorporate biblical teaching along with the physical, mental, and spiritual healing truths that I'm sharing with you today. So, no matter what you're battling, because most of us have probably got something. You might be having marital issues. You might be suffering a financial loss. Maybe you're grieving the death of a loved one. Maybe you have childhood wounds that the Lord hasn't had access yet to touch and heal. Maybe you're depressed. Or you may be helping someone, walking along someone who's depressed. But whatever you're battling, He is trustworthy. He is our living hope. So, I'm going to pray real quick, and then we'll continue. You are our living hope, Lord. I just love you so much, Father. It's just such a privilege to tell people what you did. And I am no one special, Father. You do this for anyone. You love all of us the same. So I just pray now, Holy Spirit, that each person that hears this, wherever they're at, that you would draw them closer to your heart through our story, through your truth, through your word. And that today there will be much fruit that comes from our time together. There will be healing and deliverance and freedom. There will be more transparency, more openness, less shame. And then may we always give you all the is what you need to say. In Jesus' name. At the beginning, I told you that you would hear an echo today of Pastor Josh's sermon Sunday, and he did it again, the Lord did yesterday, because back in August, I made a list of verses I wanted to memorize, all about praising God. I just went through the concordance, and I found verses about praising God. And so, just yesterday, I started with a new one. And it's Psalm 71, 5-8, and listen to it. O Lord, you alone are my hope. I've trusted you, O Lord, from my childhood. Yes, you have been with me from birth, from my mother's womb, you have cared for me. No wonder I am always praising you. My life is an example to many because you have been my strength and protection. That is why I can never stop praising you and declare your glory all day long. Is that not just funny? I mean, it just tickles me the way God does it. It's another connecting of dots. Like, here yesterday, I'm starting a new verse. It's all about He's our hope and trusting Him. So I wanted to share that with you. That's just a little tab in the